Praise the Lord. We continue this service in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Remember God's words in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 19. And the Lord remembered her. The Lord remembered Hannah. Today is the Remembrance Day, and it's also calling on us to remember our stories. At the same time, remember the faithfulness of the Lord that has carried us thus far. It's the faithfulness of the Lord that has led all these people, yesteryears, our forefathers, to lead the church thus far. And give glory and honor to God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
We continue with Methodist Team 402. It's the program. Faith of our fathers leading still in spite of dying fire and sorrow. Oh, how our hearts beat high to draw whenever we hear that glorious word.
Jesus, we thank you so much for your goodness and mercies. We thank you for this day that you have made, and our hearts rejoice, and we give you all the praise and adoration. We thank you, Lord, for your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, through whom we have life, and through whom we can rejoice this day for this celebration of our forefathers. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us safely from various places to this place. Thank you for safe conduct to this place. We are most grateful for all the wonderful things you have done for us and for our church, the Methodist Church. We thank you for the wonderful men and women that you have positioned in time and in their generation, from time to time, to assist and direct in the affairs of this church. And so, Lord, we can say we thank you, we bless you, we honor you, we appreciate all that you have done in bringing us thus far. We give you all the praise and adoration. Thank you for another occasion, this seventh in the series, to celebrate our forefathers, to celebrate the stalwarts of our church, whom you have placed at various times. You have called and used in various ways to bless our church. We are most grateful for the lives of all these men and women, those we have observed, those who have not been observed, but who have in any way contributed to the growth of our church. We are most grateful for all of these. Pray that, Lord, in all things, we remember that we do this to honor you, not just to remember these towers of the church, but to say, Lord, you have been gracious. You have been merciful. You have been faithful. What a great and good God we have. What a merciful God you are. We thank you so much for this time. We submit ourselves to your authority and pray that you bless us through this period. Let this time be a hallowed hour and let your blessings be upon us. Especially we pray for the special guest to speak to us. We pray that you grant him grace to speak to us. We pray that you grant him wisdom from above. As he chooses his words will be from you and will touch our hearts. We will be re-energized. And Lord, we will go forth to re-strengthen your church in the name of Jesus. We thank you for all others who speak. Grant them the grace to also do likewise through Jesus Christ our Lord. Please say so. You call the MC, Professor Akwa Hayford, to continue.
I will serve. I will serve. And I will serve. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, let me, in the name of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, very warmly welcome you to the seventh in the series of the S.H. Mensa Emisa Memorial Lectures. We last met at Winneba, and it was a joy sharing. Now we are at Koforidua. We trust the Lord in a similar manner will lead us through, at the end of which we'll have cause to say, yes, indeed, we have a Lord. Amen. We are at Koforidua. There are landlords. In the event of anything, we will call upon them. We'll therefore invite the lay chairman for the dowsers, for the Koforidua dowsers, to take the microphone and formally welcome us to his dowsers. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the Koforidua lay chairman.
Thank you, Mr. MC, past presiding bishop, lay president, the administrative bishop, our distinguished guest speaker, Nana Dr. Samuel K.B. Asante, on my hymn of Asante Asokori, a legal luminary by all standards, past lay president, bishop, lay chairman, standing in existing protocols. On behalf of the Diocesan Executive and the Standing Committee of the Koforidua Diocese, I welcome you all to this evening event, which is to honor the stalwarts of the Church. This being the seventh in the series, is to honor Mrs. Sophia E. Moore, the seventh Vice President of the Methodist Church Ghana, and also the first female to occupy the seat. This is to put on record that the Methodist Church Ghana practiced affirmative action long ago. History has it that March 1877, Huntress of Jabin Exiles were squatting on Kokrentumi's two lands on ill-defined terms in the environs of modern Koforidua. The colonial government decided to regularize their occupation by negotiating with Kokrentumi Hene Nana Ampau for a gift of the portion of this land south of the Nkwakwedia stream. Several accounts preceded the building of Koforidua and founding of New Drabin in 1878. The new settlers who sojourned from the Ashanti Old Drabin settled at a spot where a man called Kofi Ofori displayed his artifacts under a big tree for sale. Soon the term Kofi Oforiduase developed as a reference to the new settlement, which gradually was corrupted into Koforidua. Ladies and gentlemen, before the Methodist Church was opened at Koforidua in 1884, the seed of the church had been planted in some parts of the district already. The Methodist Church in the eastern region, and especially in the Koforidua district, started first at Adamalbe near Ebri in 1876. Therefore, the history of Ebri, where the early missionaries from Accra made a few converts and started the first Methodist Church in this part of the eastern region. From Ebri, the next place where the church was opened through some Sierra Leoneans and Fantes was later in 1879. Methodism in the then Koforidua district, now diocese, traces its origin to Ebri. The new settlement had some initial social and administrative problems which made the people determined to find a solution. For instance, there was no single educated person. So correspondence regarding administration and other literary matters were sent to Kokorintumi, a town 10 miles, that's 17 kilometers, away in the then Akim district. This agitated the minds of the chief and the people over the years. Several moves were made. In June 1884, Accra Quarterly Meeting held at Ebri agreed to recommend to Synod that a school and a church should be opened at Koforidua as a matter of urgency. In January 1885, the Synod held at Cape Coast gave approval for the opening of a school and the church. Reverend Isaac Graham was stationed by the Synod as the first resident minister and school teacher. In 1914, the societies in the Koforidua section of the then Accra Circuit was granted a circuit status. The circuit then started expanding as far as the Quell Mountains and beyond. In 1934, Nkoko section of the Koforidua Circuit was created and later granted circuit status in 1937. With time, other circuits were created until in August 1979, conference in Winneba granted a district status to the Koforidua seven circuits, which formed part of the Accra district with Koforidua as its administrative seat. Koforidua, Ebri, Late, Nkoko, Kokorintumi, Nsawem, and Mampong. At an impressive ceremony, the Koforidua district was formally inaugurated by the Most Reverend Samuel B. Isamoa, the then president of conference, and the Right Reverend Joseph Jerubanaman, who had been stationed there in 1978 as the resident superintendent, was inducted into office as the first chairman and general superintendent of the Koforidua district. The district currently consists of 19 circuits with 216 societies. The diocese sprouts from the Ekuapim area through the new Jabin traditional area to many parts of the Achim area. It has 204 public and special schools comprising 56 KG, 89 primary, and 59 junior high schools. Besides, there are two public senior high schools. Ladies and gentlemen, the diocese is into mushroom cultivation, raising Adumkraba organic oyster mushroom, and will be sold at an affordable price to you. I entreat you to purchase for your all-year use. We have put at your disposal our best hospitality for your period of stay. Once again, you are warmly welcome to the Sixth Diocese in the connection. Please don't forget to purchase your organic mushroom. Akwaba.
I deliberately delayed mentioning his name. Now that you have heard him, let me formally then also introduce him as the lay chairman for the Koforidua Diocese. Ask me his name, and I will tell you. It is Brother Samuel B. Mensah Jr. Brother Samuel B. Mensah Jr. The lay chairman, Koforidua Diocese. Thank you. I've also deliberately omitted any introduction of the purpose why we are here. There is somebody better equipped to do that. But for now, let me invite Brother Timothy E. Osam Dudu, past Vice President of Conference, to tell us why we are gathered here. Why we are gathered here. Shall we welcome him with a clap offering, please?
The presiding bishop, the lay president, the associate bishop, the past and present lay presidents, diocesan bishops past and present, diocesan lay chairman past and present, our August speaker, Nana Amahene of New Jabin Traditional Area, honorable members of parliament, the clergy and the lay of Methodist Church Ghana, dignitaries from other churches, schools, colleges, and universities, family members of past vice presidents, past guest speakers, the municipal chief executive, Nananum, the single invited guest, the press, ladies and gentlemen. I will serve. We have met this evening of Wednesday, 15 March 2017, at this Wesley Cathedral Cofodria to listen to the seventh address in the series of annual memorial lectures which come under the name of the late Samuel Hansen Emisa, OBE, KGB, referred to as S.H. Emisa Memorial Lectures. The late S.H. Emisa was the first vice president of Methodist Conference from 1977 to 1979. He was also the first African principal of Wesley College, Kumasi, and also the first general secretary of All African Conference of Churches, initially with his head office located at Kitwe, Zambia. The presiding sir, the distinguished invited guests. The S.H. Emisa Memorial Lectures were initiated by the lay people of Methodist Church Ghana in the year 209 during the celebration of the 60th anniversary of Methodist lay movement in Accra. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, these lectures were initiated primarily in honor and in recognition of great contribution of the vice and lay president of Methodist Conference, Ghana, and also their contribution to the church and Ghana and mankind in general. The series of lectures have so far attracted great speakers and outstanding personalities who have distinguished themselves in various fields of endeavor and disciplines. We wish to assure you that this existing pattern and the standards set for the memorial lectures will be maintained. Distinguished guests, 1 whole year after this great initiative of 209, that is the year 2010, the year was used specifically to plan and seek approval of Methodist Conference. And so, in the following year, on 7 June 2011, the first of the series of memorial lectures was delivered by no less a person than the then presiding bishop of Methodist Conference, the Most Reverend Professor Emmanuel Kwaku Asante. The first lecture was in honor of the first vice president of conference, Pius H. Emisa. Subsequently, each year, one vice or lay president was to be honored. For the past 6 years, therefore, six past vice presidents had been honored in succession by six previous memorial lectures. The lectures were well delivered by six outstanding speakers. The details of these have been provided in the brochures in your hands. Please secure one if you have not done so. Presiding Bishop, ladies and gentlemen, this seventh lecture, which you are privileged to listen to this evening, is equally unique. It is being delivered in honor of the first female vice president of Methodist Conference. She was also the seventh vice president, a woman of several parts, a wonderful personality, and an embodiment of Methodist Women's Fellowship in her days, and a Methodist to the core. She is the late Mrs. Sophia Evelyn Moore, who was the vice president of conference from the year 1989 to 1991. The brochure, as indicated above, provides details on Mrs. Moore. Brothers and sisters, the first four of these memorial lectures have been compiled and almost ready for publication. As usual, distinguished invited guest, this evening's topic has been prayerfully and carefully chosen to reflect the critical period of constitutional rule our dear nation is currently enjoying. The lecture will be expertly delivered by one of our own, a true Methodist, an outstanding lawyer, an international scholar par excellence, a traditionalist, an author, an intelligentsia, an icon, and a statesman whose contribution to national affairs is admired by many. He is in the person of Nana Susubiri Krobia Asante, also known as Dr. S.K.B. Asante, Omahini of Asante, Asokore. He will be appropriately introduced in due course. Beside him, Bishop, distinguished invited guest, I wish to assure you that there is a lot to learn tonight. Be prepared for it. Thank you and God bless you. And to God be the glory. Thank you.
So we've been eloquently been told the purpose for this meeting. But we cannot proceed without introducing to you the chairman for this event. We need a shepherd to take care of the flock. And this afternoon, we have one of us, a past lay chairman of the Accra Diocese, Sister Christiana Akwodoy, who has kindly consented to perform this role for us. She will come and introduce our chairman for this event. Shall we, with a clap offering, welcome Christy Akwodoy.
Thank you, Reverend Tim. Past presiding bishop, lay president, Brother Kwame Boafu, past lay presidents, Admi Bishop, our guest speaker, Nana Susubiri Krobia Asante, families of the SHA Missa, and Sister Sophia Moore, the clergy and the lay, brothers and sisters in the Lord, the media fraternity, standing in all existing protocol, I will serve. I will serve. Ebenezer, thus far the Lord has brought us. 7 years in earnest, remembering our fathers and mothers. This occasion, this evening, requires that we have somebody to pilot us as we hang in the air, yet to land safely, and to do a successful and enjoyable, to a successful and enjoyable end. Brothers and sisters in the Lord, We had no problem at all because we have one of our own, a reputable and accomplished lawyer by profession, with his own chambers where young lawyers say they are tutelage. In fact, he's a seasoned and astute lawyer. He is a humble servant of the Lord's vineyard. He has served the church in various capacities. He's a family man and a very passionate football enthusiast. And I'm talking about no other person than our number two administrator of the Methodist Church Ghana. He is very competent. And I can tell you, he will drive us to our destination safely and very comfortably. Ladies and gentlemen, please, with a round of applause, help me to welcome no other person but our own lay president, Brother Kwame Boafo. Oh, my brother. You are welcome. This is the audience. Audience, the chair. I thank you.
Thank you, Mr. MC. Past presiding bishop, past lay presidents, the administrative bishop, all bishops, all other protocols observed. I want to assure the MC that when it's about the Methodist Church, I'm always ready to take up any challenge, and therefore I accept the honor of being the chairman for this august function. And I thought you would clap for me for this. This is the 7th SHMSA Memorial Lecture, and it has been held successfully over the years for the last 7 years. If it has been successful, it is due to the collective efforts of both the lay and clergy, office holders and non-office holders alike, of the church, the lay movement and its organizations. Successive executives of the church, the presiding bishops, lay presidents and administrative bishops, the bishop, lay chairman and senior secretaries, and every one throughout the connection have, with one accord, supported all successive SHMSA Memorial Lectures. The lectures are designed to honor all laymen and women in the church, past and present. It is not only for only to honor only past lay presidents or vice presidents of conference. And every year we have taken pains to emphasize that the lay presidents and vice presidents are only singled out to represent the many known and unknown anonymous lay men and women who have sacrificed their all for almost 2 centuries of our church's history, with dedicated commitment in selfless service to the church and humanity, and who even now, continue to serve as a source of inspiration to the present generation, both young and old. This year's topic is the Constitution of Ghana and Freedom of Religion, Challenges and the Way Forward. And you might have realized that over the years, our topics have centered around religion, democracy, governance, constitutionalism. Obviously, due to the truism that the church cannot be apolitical, even if we cannot be involved in active partisan politics. Therefore, this year we chose this topic because we believe that you'll be well educated to serve our country better and to understand things that are going on around us. At the appropriate time, I will introduce the speaker for the occasion, but I implore you, and I believe I can trust you to cooperate with me as you've done so over the years, whilst I chair this function. And with your support, I believe that I'll be able to steer this function to a successful end. Thank you and God bless you all.
I believe we are also thanking him for having accepted to be our chairman. In the Methodist Church, we have a tradition. We elect people into offices. Thereupon, they have to be inducted to assume formal office. The next item on our program is a very important one. Observance of silence and prayers for fathers and mothers of the church. This is a solemn event. It is only appropriate to invite our administrative bishop of conference, Right Reverend Dr. Paul Kwabena Bwafu, to please proceed to lead us in this important item.
Dear Christian friends, brothers and sisters, as Uncle Tim has said, this is a solemn moment as we bring back memories of our past leaders, fathers and mothers who have gone before us. Our hearts still yearn for them, and we're looking back to see them as they led us. Though the bitter grief has softened, a dollar pain abides still in us. We give thanks that they now live and reign with you as a great crowd of witnesses. We know they surround us with their blessings and offer you hymns of praise and thanksgiving. May we who are left behind also tread where they trod in faith, to resolve to live a dedicated, committed life unto you. And may we continue to spread the scriptural holiness that you, through which you brought us to being. This and many blessings we ask through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen.
Shall we give a clap offering unto Jesus? Mr. Chairman, presiding bishop, who else should we have invited to perform this role but our administrative bishop? He has excellently performed this function. Yet another round of applause. And thank you very much, administrative bishop. We now want to recognize some of the members of the families of SHA Misa and Mrs. Sophia Moore. You will recall the event highlights Mrs. Sophia Moore, but it is also the general name for this event is SHA Misa Memorial Lectures. I know we have representation here from both families. May I ask both families to be on their feet? We want to recognize them. I will mention a few of the names as I have, but may I kindly ask the families of Mrs. Sophia Moore and SHA Misa present with us. Please be on your feet. Let us recognize you. I have a few names here. Let me very quickly go through them. Mrs. Rose E. Newman, Mr. Ebo Anoui, Mrs. Jane Amo, Mr. Peter Ebenezer Paintel, Mrs. Florence E. Blankson, Madam Charlotte Paintel, Mrs. Cecilia Arthur, Mr. Robert Paintel, Mr. Fred K. Moore, Mrs. Lodina Yorson, Mr. Samuel Newman. These are present. I will kindly ask you to turn your face towards your congregation. Let them recognize you appropriately. On behalf of the chairman, on behalf of the presiding bishop, the lay president, and all of us here gathered, we would want to thank you very much for having given us very able leaders. And so today we stand here recognizing them. May you likewise be recognized in due season for Christ's sake. Amen. Please sit. I invited the families of both Mrs. Moore and Sir S.H. Emisa. And I didn't know them by faces, by names. I received a list, and I presumed this list captured both the Moores and the S.H.A. Emisas. If there is any omission, can I please ask that you be on your feet? The Emisa family, are there any Emisa family? Oh, they did stand. Did the names that we mentioned, did the names include any of you? I requested for names, and And for that reason, I said we're not going to cover all of you. I'm afraid you are duly recognized by our Lord and our Savior, Jesus. May you be blessed in his name. Amen. Now, we have a cultural display and a choreography. May I invite performers to take the floor.
When I am down and all my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden be, and I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Stop! the days of my life, I praise you. Everything that I have now, you gave to me, Baba. Lord, I say, for your love, I'm grateful. Jesus, you love me plenty, you came to die for me. Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nissi, I am the Lion. Ooh. Oh, I search around, there's no one else like you. I love Judah, Judah, man, man, man. I receive. Ah, yeah. God, in your grace and mercy, I want to follow me. Yeah.
He has given me victory.
He has given me victory.
God has given me victory.
God has given me victory.
He has given me victory.
He has given me victory.
Hallelujah. I am a receive. God in your grace and mercy is always the follow.
Yeah, yeah. God has given me
victory. He has given me victory.
Yeah.
Heavenly blessings that he might receive. Ah, yeah. God, your grace and mercy is always the following.
These are some of the gifts of grace that the Lord has bestowed upon. The gift of grace that the Lord has bestowed upon the church, the young and upcoming ones, soon to replace and take control. Mr. Chairman, presiding bishop, past presidents and vice presidents, bishops, present and past lay chairmen, our ministers, the families of Mrs. Moore and S.H. Mintz Emisa, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, all that you have watched, all that you have observed will amount to what we describe as a teaser. You were being teased for the action itself. Now we are going to have a reveal. We are now going to reveal the substance. I would suggest you sit right in your seats so as not to be overwhelmed by events. And so, with your permission, I will invite our chairman to kindly introduce our guest speaker. Shall we welcome our chairman with a round of applause?
Thank you, the young and energetic MC. Past presiding bishop, who has graciously consented to represent the presiding bishop. Past presiding bishop, the Most Reverend Robert Kwesi Abuaji Mensah. I have to thank you so much because you are informed of your tax only a few hours ago, but you managed to be here. Christian friends, all other protocols observed. The topic for today, or this evening, as you all know, is the Constitution of Ghana and Freedom of Religion, Challenges and the Way Forward. And we I'm highly honored tonight, because the person to deliver the lecture is one of our own. He is a die-in-the-wool Methodist, and he has passed through the Methodist educational system, at least in his formative years. He is no other person than Nana Susubibi Krobia Asante, the Omanian of Asqua traditional area in the Ashanti region, known in private life as Nana Dr. SKB Asante. Last month, on the 27th of February, 2017, it's not 2007, 2017, last month, a first script was held in his honor. A first script is a series, a collection of scholarly writings held or given in honor of an important scholar. And I had the honor of attending it with the presiding bishop and the administrative bishop at the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences. And there, he proudly declared, and I quote, "I was made by the Methodist Church. I was made by the Methodist Church." He showed gratitude to us. He loves his church, and the idea that the Methodists had a hand in shaping him. We could not have chosen a better speaker for this topic, because it's about the Constitution of Ghana, the present Constitution of Ghana that was promulgated in 1992. Because Nana happens to be the chairman of the Constitutional Committee of Experts, the chairman of the Committee of Experts that formulated proposals for the Constitution. And maybe we've forgotten about the settings at that time. This Constitution, remember, was born out of cynicism and skepticism, because it was after years of military rule. And therefore, even those who were selected as experts were viewed with mistrust and suspicion. Remember that the Bar Association, Ghana Bar Association, boycotted it. But in the end, Nana went ahead with his team and produced this constitution that we all hallow. And at the end of the day, it became obvious that it had to be Nana. Because Nana exhibited credentials as an astute negotiator. He was very tactful, honest, impartial, and unassuming. And at the end of the day, almost everybody came to the conclusion that this is the constitution that we need, that including the Ghana Bar Association. And I thought you would clap for this. Maybe that's why we say Ghanaians have short memory. But in those days, it was something else. So I agree with Nana when in his own words, he said, the constitution provided the basic structure of the current constitution of Ghana, which has endured for more than two decades, a rare phenomenon in Africa. Because nobody with the mistrust, nobody thought that it could last that long. It needed Nana to be doing that. Those who know him, I don't know whether it's permissible to say that he's a humble person. I don't know whether it's permissible to say that of a chief. But he's somebody who is so humble, respects everybody, very courteous. And I'm happy to introduce him as the next speaker. Normally, when we are preparing for, when we are choosing a speaker, we will give three names to the presiding bishop to take one. When we chose Nana, it was only him that represented to the presiding bishop. And he never hesitated for a moment in agreeing that we had made a good selection. Nana, we all know, is a legal luminary par excellence. He served from 1969 to 1977 as the Solicitor General and Deputy Attorney General of Ghana, and then the Chief Legal Advisor and a Director at the UN Center on Transnational Cooperation, New York, from 1977 to 1992. In fact, he was a pioneer law lecturer, those who began the law school in 1961 to 1965. If you look at your age, then you can understand what we're talking about. And the acting head of the Law Department, then the Law Department at the University of Ghana in 1962. And therefore, he was very much involved in the establishment of the Faculty of Law of the University of Ghana. His profile can be found on pages 12 to 14. We have only given a brief of his profile, so you can imagine what we would have written if we meant to write everything. Ladies and gentlemen, we are privileged to have a traditional ruler, a lawyer, an author, and a great Methodist to be the speaker for tonight. Nana Susubrubu Krobia Asante. Nana, Casabrebre, 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 una nam ye tio.
Mr. Chairman, our own friend and brother, Kwame Buafo, the presiding bishop, the administrative bishop, Bishop Bosman, past lay presidents, past vice lay presidents, ministers of the gospel, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, my dear Christian brothers and sisters. Yes, I was indeed made by the Methodist Church. Some time ago, I wrote an article in the Christian Sentinel in which I disclosed my connections with a connection. I will just point out two of these connections today. When I was a little boy worshiping in Asokore Methodist Church, the superintendent minister was the Reverend Samuel Awotu Pratt, father of our presiding bishop. And I was taught in my last year, Sunday 6, at Achimota School by a certain J.K. Buafo, father of our lay president. As a matter of fact, I was there when his father married his mother. And I served as one of the stewards at the wedding. I have to make a confession. When we were little boys, we were serving, you know, we would take the donuts and the cakes and so forth. And the senior boy said, "You don't take everything to the table. You divert some of them for yourselves." So that's my confession. Bishop Bosman was my pastor at the Rich, Accra Rich Church. The presiding bishop, Bishop Abu Haji Mensah, went to the same university, Nottingham, except that I was there a few years before him. I also recall fondly that at the wedding of Mr. and Mrs. J.K. Buafo, a certain minister called F. Yekosiakuban was preaching. And he was preaching on the virtues of love and how important that spouses should love each other. His wife was sitting down there. Then he said in Fante, "Mira osihoi, mi pienda anyo." My dear Christian brothers and sisters, I have been asked to deliver this lecture in the light of the recent controversy over alleged violations of the constitutional guarantees of freedom of religion, particularly in our educational institutions. Before delving into this controversy, it will be appropriate to make a few tentative remarks on the concept of religious freedom. Now, since I'm addressing a gathering of eminent theologians, it will be presumptuous of me to attempt a definition of religion even within the meaning of the 1992 Constitution. In any case, the Supreme Court of Ghana has not pronounced on this issue. The University of Minnesota Human Rights Center sheds some light on the definition of religion as follows. Quote, the word religion, which comes from the Latin word religare, means to tie, to bind fast. This etymology is favored by many based on its ability to explain the power religion has over people and the communities in which they live. Religion is commonly but not always associated with a particular system of faith and worship of a transcendent deity or deities. In human rights discourse, however, the use of the term religion also includes support for the right to non-religious beliefs, such as atheism and agnosticism. In 1993, the Human Rights Committee, an independent body of 18 experts selected through the UN process, described religion as a belief in, quote, theistic, non-theistic, and atheistic beliefs, as well as a right not to profess any religion or belief. It should also be noted that the Supreme Court of the United States of America has not made a definitive pronouncement on the definition of religion. It has, however, offered the following parameters in approaching this delicate matter. Number one, these are the parameters. The first is that the court will not inquire into the truth and validity of any religious belief, since this is essentially a subjective matter. Freedom of religion will be subverted by such an inquiry. The second point is that religious belief is something more than essentially sociological, philosophical, economic, and political views. The third is that freedom of religion does not require belief in any particular dogma or any supernatural force or supreme being. It must, however, be sincere and meaningful and occupy a place in the life of its possessor that is parallel to that filled by the orthodox belief in God of those who are customarily regarded as religious persons. This is from somebody called Jonathan Neville. What then is freedom of religion? Freedom of religion has to be understood within the context of the tenets of our own Constitution of Ghana. This will be addressed later. However, the word freedom, the ingredient of freedom of religion, generally means immunity from governmental compulsion in regard to religious matters. The concept prohibits governmental regulation of religious beliefs or governmental regulation of the dissemination of religious beliefs. It also debars acts that impede the observation of religious practices or acts that amount to discrimination of one religion over another, where such acts are not otherwise justifiable in terms of valid governmental aims. Now, one of the most authoritative formulations of freedom of religion and belief is to be found in Article 18 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, adopted by the United Nations in 1966, which reads as follows. Quote, paragraph one. Everyone shall have the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. This right shall include freedom to have or to adopt a religion or belief of his choice, and freedom either individually or in community with others, and in public or private, to manifest his religion or belief in worship, observance, practice, and teaching. 2, no one shall be subject to coercion, which would impair his freedom to have or to adopt the religion or belief of his choice. And 3, freedom to manifest one's religion or beliefs may be subject only to such limitations as are prescribed by law and are necessary to protect public safety, order, health, or morals, or the fundamental rights and freedoms of others. And finally, the states parties to the covenant undertake to have respect for the liberty of parents and, when applicable, legal guardians to ensure the religious and moral education of their children in conformity with their own convictions. Quotations close. So, my dear friends, on the basis of the foregoing principles, traditional African religion enjoys all the constitutional guarantees of freedom of religion. This means that constitutionally, the state cannot discriminate against traditional religions or exclude adherence to such religions from official public functions. And I must say, the state, I'm afraid, cannot sanction pastors who claim to have seen Jesus assume the form of a beast. I should also point out that the constitutional guarantee of freedom of belief under Article 21B would protect atheism. I have to point out that in saying this, as a constitutional lawyer, I am by no means disavowing or repudiating my Christian faith. I remain, as I said, a firm Methodist Christian. But I only plead for religious tolerance as a supreme core value enshrined in our Constitution. Now, I will go back now to the controversy which has engaged our attention for a number of years. It will be recalled. I have a little sip of water. It will be recalled that in the year 2015, Muslim leaders made representations to the National Peace Council containing the following allegations, inter alia, among others. Some public schools in Ghana, as well as some individual heads and teachers of schools, as well as officials of some institutions in Ghana, have made it a point to constantly violate Article 21, Clause C, of the 1992 Constitution of the Republic of Ghana, which states that all persons shall have the right to freedom to practice any religion and to manifest such practice. It was alleged that Muslim students are compelled to accept a faith other than their own in both public and faith-based schools. And then they went on to say, we are even more concerned about the prevalence of this discriminatory practice in government non-mission schools where heads and teachers ought to have known better the position of our laws. Similarly, they went on, some Muslim women in some public and private institutions have come under constant embarrassment and humiliation for wearing their veils to express their identity and to cover what is believed to be nudity or nakedness in Islam. quotations close. So that was the gravamen of their complaints. We had a subsequent discussion with Christian leaders, and this discussion elicited the following responses from some Christian leaders. Number one, the Christian leaders urged that the National Peace Council should not confine itself to addressing the complaint leveled by the Muslim leadership. The council should also consider the practices of Muslim institutions that may raise similar issues. For example, it is alleged that the Islamic University strictly insists on a uniform dress code for males and females without any exception or provision for adherence to other faiths. And the second point made by the Christian leaders was as follows. Christian mission schools consider certain classes or curricula as an integral part of their moral or spiritual training for all students attending these institutions. These classes are known in advance as mandatory requirements to reflect the moral values of the institution. So the Christian leaders regard such courses, curricula, and classes as a distinctive service of the institutions. They are not meant to compel students to accept their religion, but offer a faith-based moral training to youngsters. This, they contend, should not be characterized as a violation of Article 21C. These obligatory classes are known in advance to all prospective students, and they are freely subscribed to by students of all faiths. Then they went on to point out that a more fundamental issue arises in the case of private faith-based schools, which consider their educational establishment as their way not only of offering their distinctive faith-based training, but also part of their mission work, which involves winning more souls for the faith they profess. The fourth point they made is that they point out that all the above activities of Christian institutions cannot be summarily or indiscriminately condemned as compelling students to accept faiths other than their original faiths in violation of the Constitution. And their final point is that although Christian missions, mission schools are partly supported by state funds, they have not, that is these schools and their missions, have not relinquished their faith-based guidance and management. In any case, they maintain that their schools are run on the basis of a partnership between government and the missions, and the contents of that partnership should govern their relations. The above summary of divergent perspectives sets the stage for an analysis of the constitutional provisions relevant to the challenges posed by the exercise of freedom of religion. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to warn you that what I've done is just setting the stage. We are now going to do the actual analysis. And so, so take a deep breath. We have more to go. I propose to discuss the constitutional issues raised by all religious leaders as a prelude to devising appropriate mechanisms to address their concerns. I recognize that in doing so, I'm treading on delicate grounds assigned to the Supreme Court. As you know, the Supreme Court is the only body which is empowered to interpret the Constitution. However, we must remember that the Supreme Court can pronounce on who is right or who is wrong, but is not necessarily able to mediate between competing interests. The latter is the function of mediators and peacemakers, such as the National Peace Council, or religious bodies. So sometimes it is necessary to make recommendations which go beyond the narrow confines of the law in this regard. Now, what are the relevant constitutional provisions? Although it does not explicitly mention religious freedom, it is worth noting that Article 21B stipulates that all persons shall have the right to freedom of thought, conscience, and belief. Admittedly, this clause encompasses freedom of thought, conscience, and belief in matters other than religion. But it can hardly be disputed that freedom of conscience and belief may have a religious element, and therefore reinforces the concept of religious freedom and tolerance. However, the more crucial provision is Article 21C, which expressly guarantees freedom to practice any religion and to manifest such practice. It is this provision which is specifically mentioned by the Muslim leaders in their representations to the National Peace Council. The said Article 21C states, quote, "All persons shall have the right to freedom to practice any religion and to manifest such practice," quotations close. The above provision is qualified by Article 21, Clause 4E, which stipulates that nothing in or done under the authority of a law shall be held to be inconsistent with or in contravention of this article, to the extent that the law in question makes provision that is reasonably required for the purpose of safeguarding the people of Ghana against the teaching or propagation of a doctrine which exhibits or encourages disrespect for the nationhood of Ghana, the national symbols and emblems, or incites hatred against other members of the community. So, this is an exception that the state can make a law which safeguards the people of Ghana against the teaching or propaganda of a doctrine which exhibits or encourages disrespect for the nationhood of Ghana or the national symbols of Ghana and emblems, or incites hatred against other members of the community. Now, it's important to remember that all these fundamental rights are subject to certain qualifications. So it is also important to remember that the entire Chapter 5 of the Constitution, which guarantees all fundamental human rights and freedoms, is premised on two principles enunciated at the beginning of chapter, namely Article 12, which proclaims as follows. 12.1, the fundamental human rights and freedoms enshrined in this chapter shall be respected and upheld by the executive, legislature, and judiciary, and all other organs of government and its agencies, and where applicable to them by all natural and legal persons in Ghana, and shall be enforceable by the courts as provided for in this constitution. Then Clause 2 says, every person in Ghana, whatever his race, place of origin, political opinion, color, religion, creed, or gender, shall be entitled to the fundamental human rights and freedoms of the individual contained in this chapter, but, and this is my own italics, subject to respect for the rights and freedoms of others and for the public interest. If you don't get anything at all, remember that all the fundamental rights and freedoms are subject to respect for the rights and freedoms of others and for the public interest. So I would like to emphasize that a person's entitlement to the fundamental human rights and freedoms guaranteed under the 1992 Constitution, including freedom of religion, is subject to respect for the public interest. Now, in this regard, it may be helpful to point out that in the constitutional law of the United States, a distinction is sometimes made between freedom to believe an activity undertaken pursuant to religious beliefs. That is freedom to believe, the belief itself, and then the activity which you undertake pursuant to the religion, which is sometimes called conduct, is distinguished. Now, the right to believe was originally accorded absolute protection, and even now is accorded very strong protection under US law. But activity undertaken pursuant to religious beliefs or conduct, which corresponds to the word manifesting under our constitution, may be appropriately regulated in the public interest. So it is important to appreciate that the above provisions of the 1992 Constitution guarantee, which guarantee freedom, fundamental human rights and freedoms for all, are subject to certain qualifications. Now, another crucial constitution provision relevant to the issues under discussion is Article 17, which prohibits discrimination. Clause 1 of Article 17 stipulates all persons shall be equal before the law. And clause 2 then goes on to state, a person shall not be discriminated against on grounds of gender, race, color, ethnic origin, religion, creed, or social economic status. And then clause 3 defines discrimination. What is discrimination? For the purposes of this article, discriminate means to give different treatment to different persons attributable only or mainly to their descriptions by race, place of origin, political opinions, color, gender, religion, or creed, whereby persons of one description are subjected to disabilities or restrictions to which persons of another description are not made subject or are granted privileges or advantages which are not granted to persons of another description. It's a very important provision when it comes to the recent controversy about President Akufo-Addo allegedly cutting the sod for a national Christian cathedral, which has been challenged in the Supreme Court as unconstitutional because it's supposed to give preferential treatment to Christians. We shall come back to that later on. Now, we have special provisions relating to children. Since some of the issues raised affect children, we have Article 28 of the Constitution, which says, in Clause 4, no child shall be deprived by any other persons of medical treatment, education, or any other social benefit by reason only of religious or other beliefs. That's very important. Then we have the directive principles of state policy, which are spelled out under Articles, Chapter 6 of the Constitution. Now, Article 38 of this provides that the state shall provide educational facilities at all levels and in all regions, and shall, to the extent feasible, make those facilities available to all citizens. I will also refer you to Clause 5 of this Article 35, which is the integration clause, which says the state shall actively promote the integration of the peoples of Ghana and prohibit discrimination and prejudice on grounds of place of origin, circumstances of birth, ethnic origin, gender or religion, creed or other beliefs. It means that we are all in together and the state shall do its best to integrate all of us irrespective of religion. Now, what did the Constitution say about private schools? Article 25, Clause 2 says, every person shall have the right at his own expense to establish and maintain a private school or schools at all levels and at such categories and in such and in accordance with such conditions as may be provided by law. Now, it is pertinent to note that this provision is reinforced by Article 26, Clause 1, which says, every person is entitled to enjoy, profess, maintain, and promote any culture, language, tradition, or religion subject to the provisions of this Constitution. So having mapped out very briefly the relevant constitutional provisions, now let's tackle the main issues. Take a deep breath again. We are now stage three. Based on the above-mentioned constitutional provisions, I would respectfully recommend the following approach as a framework for a dialogue among stakeholders on the delicate issues raised by religious and other leaders. These recommendations contain my suggestions as to the way forward in the light of the challenges which we'll discuss. Number one is a late violation of the right to freedom to practice any religion and manifest it. The position in public schools funded by the state. We want to deal with public schools first, then faith-based schools, then private schools, and then we deal with other matters, and then we are over. The most serious charge leveled by the Muslim leaders is the alleged persistent violation of Article 21, 1C by denying Muslim students the right to practice their freedom of religion or to manifest it. More specifically, it is alleged that Muslim students are compelled to accept a faith other than their own in public schools. If this is true, and it's an important if, then it constitutes a grave violation of Article 21.1c. A public educational establishment which does not profess any religious orientation or affiliation should not practice any discrimination against any religious group in the school, nor should it compel students of one faith to accept another faith. The Constitution prohibits discrimination against Christians as well as Muslim students. However, the issues are more complex than the crude practice of compelling students to worship in another faith. I have been advised by school authorities that sometimes the school convenes a general assembly for a short prayer to commence daily activities rather than like the invocation of prayers in parliament or other public gatherings, where a short opening prayer is accepted as a signal for commencement of business. Is such practice objectionable? If this were in America, I would say yes, because in American constitutional law, the concept of the prohibition of establishment of religion by the state has made it imperative for the Supreme Court of the United States to hold that no prayers are permissible in any public school. But my submission that in Ghana, it should not be objectionable if one or two conditions is satisfied. First, the form of prayer could invoke God without specific mention of the peculiarities of a particular faith. Second, provision could be made for a Christian prayer and a Muslim prayer either simultaneously or on alternative days. This practice has been universally accepted in Ghana and should be preserved as our distinctive contribution to religious tolerance. If faith-based schools object to this compromise, then appropriate provision should be made for the minority group to say their prayers somewhere simultaneously with a larger group. I'll come to that later on. But does an institution have an obligation to provide separate places for full worship? A public establishment should find a place for a minority. However, this may not amount to the building of, say, a mosque or a church if the school authorities do not have the resources to build a separate church or a separate mosque. That, after all, is a governmental expenditure of public schools, and the government will have to decide whether it has the resources to build churches and mosques for all public schools. In the light of financial constraints, it should be enough to provide a room for the minority to worship. Where the school is willing to provide space for a mosque or a church, but faces hostility from the community for the project, the civil authorities must intervene. Freedom to practice religion is subject to certain qualifications, as I pointed out. First, the exercise of that freedom must not incite hostility against any community. In other words, the practices must not condemn other members of the community. Second, the exercise of freedom of religion is subject to the public interest and respect for the right of others. We all can accept the proposition that no religious group has a right to occupy a motorway for the purposes of worshiping, or conduct all-night noisy services to the annoyance and disturbance of others. The injunction to make a joyful noise, in my view, does not warrant the making of a jarring noise. We should remember, however, that in our history, just as in the history of the United States, public education was originally predominantly sponsored and organized by missions, mainly Christian missions, with a pronounced emphasis on social values, admittedly inspired by spiritual values. An American author has said, almost all education is entrusted to the clergy. There's a free exercise of religion in the American Constitution, protected not only, not simply the private worship of an individual, but also non-governmental yet public education of citizens, the very foundation of democracy. On this analogy, Christian missions carry out a public education to the extent that they instill certain faith-based values as a foundation for our secular democracy. Care should therefore be exercised in prohibiting all religious affiliation or identity, even in public schools, provided there's no overt discrimination against members of one religious group. Now, the wearing of the veil could also be a matter of pragmatic accommodation, with Muslims being permitted to wear their veil in a prescribed manner that assures clear identification of the person concerned. I'm still talking about public schools. On the issue of admission, the Constitution guarantees equal access to all public schools, provided they satisfy the prescribed academic criteria, except where affirmative action is taken to promote the admission of students from deprived or disadvantaged places pursuant to the relative principles of state policy. Now, we come to faith-based schools, which are supported fully or partially with public funds. This is the most difficult area. The treatment of students of various faiths in the above category of institutions is fraught with delicate issues which require the spirit of accommodation and compromise to devise a solution. It may appear logical to argue that missionary schools supported by state funds should be fully assimilated to public schools in all respects because they are funded by. Somebody is objecting. I'll repeat that. It without the risk of interruption. It may appear logical to argue that missionary schools supported by state funds should be fully assimilated to public schools in all respects. On that basis, no religion or denomination should be allowed to have any distinctive influence in curricula or otherwise in the establishment. However, such an approach ignores that historically, as I have said above, Western education in Ghana was almost exclusively initiated by Christian missions who have established certain traditions in the schools. The later reception of financial support from government does not detract from the distinct traditions and values that they have inculcated over the years. Thus, as noted above, they insist, and quite properly in my view, on certain obligatory classes to instill their moral outlook in training for young men and women without compelling the students to accept their faith. Now, if this is characterized as promoting religion, culture, or tradition, it is constitutionally sanctioned, as I've said, by Article 26.1. However, with respect, even in this situation, I would advise that faith-based institutions should desist from the following practice in the interest of peace and accommodation. One, compelling students of other faiths to accept the religion of the dominant denomination. Wherever appropriate, they should provide for alternative places of worship and other facilities. Refusing admission to students of other faiths is another thing which I will not recommend. Publicly supported institutions must be accessible to all citizens as provided in the Constitution. And so we now turn to private school funded exclusively from private sources. And what is the position here? The Constitution guarantees a right to establish private schools at the founder's own expense. A private educational establishment may choose to promote a particular religion, tradition, or culture, subject, of course, to the Constitution. This position poses a number of issues. Can a private school established by a particular mission exclude students of other faiths from the school? It is arguable that a private school is not subject to the various obligations which the Constitution imposes on public institutions. Since it was privately established to promote a particular religion or tradition, it would be doctrinally unacceptable for it to admit students of other faiths and to provide facilities for the propagation of a faith which is repugnant to the establishment. So constitutionally, it may well be that a private mission school cannot be prevailed upon to accept students professing other faiths or to make provision for their training in another faith. However, and this is an important however, if Ghana is seriously committed to promoting religious pluralism and tolerance as well as a national integration, as indicated under directed principles of state policy, it cannot achieve these major objectives by a rigid insistence on constitutional rights. An exclusionary policy inevitably generates resentment, having regard to the preponderance of certain mission schools. Such resentment may find expression in the organization of schools of other faith with a stridently exclusive policy. That could be a recipe for the establishment of hotbeds of radicalism linked to external sects, extremist sects, which has been the bane of other countries. In my view, the more we learn to live and study together, the more we learn about each other's religion, the more we can move on as a united country, sustained by basic values, which will strengthen our democracy and enhance our stability as a united nation. The position in hospitals is also a delicate one. I submit that the strict requirements of health may dictate total uniformity of outfit in an operating theater. The freedom to manifest religion does not warrant wearing an unapproved dress code in the operating room, in my view. Insistence on uniformity for all does not amount to discrimination unless other groups are also allowed to wear their religious outfit. I humbly plead that not every matter should be elevated to one of religious practice leading to unnecessary tension. The American approach of distinguishing between freedom to believe and
Similarly, as conceded by one of the leaders of the Muslim delegation, it is eminently proper to expose the
full face of the nurse or health officer administering medicine or treatment to a patient. That should not raise a crucial issue of doctrinal controversy. There are certain areas in my submission where unnecessary complications are raised by insistence on religious identity. Schools may permit diversity of headwear among female students, but it may be, it would be preposterous to expect religious adherents to depart from, say, football outfit. Can you imagine wearing turbans on the football field? Or military outfits. Respectfully, a man's commitment to religion is not diminished or denigrated by reason of uniformity in certain cases properly grounded in the public interest. In the public interest? Is it all right? In the public interest, health or good order. The group that violates this is not the victim of discrimination, but the proponent of special treatment. Now, it is highly significant that we have lived in harmony in a pluralistic society. We've gone to school together, worked together, and lived together in harmony. Religious groups that have always had distinct and exclusive ways of handling interdenominational matters may have to face the challenge of a pluralistic society in a secular Ghana where no religion prevails as a state religion. Now, I would say that faith-based schools, wedded to their traditional practices, may find accommodation difficult. But history teaches us that churches have often had to bend a little in order to survive. Consider the events of the former communist world, where religious denominations had to adapt. The directive principles of state policy enunciated in Article 35 demonstrate the state's overriding objective of ensuring national integration. Clause 5 specifically enjoins the state to actively promote the integration of peoples of Ghana and prohibit discrimination and prejudice on grounds of place of origin, circumstance of birth, ethnic origin, gender, religion, creed, and other beliefs. This objective of national integration would be undermined by a strident insistence on the exhibition of the factors that divide us. This admonition with respect applies to Muslim, Christians, and traditional African religions. Now, in the past few days, it has been reported in the media that a citizen of Ghana has initiated proceedings in the Supreme Court to challenge the constitutionality of a state's alleged support to the construction of a Christian cathedral. In the US, such support would raise questions as to whether the constitutional prohibition on the establishment of religion by the state has been violated. Our constitution does not have such an establishment clause. However, our constitution does not permit discrimination of one religion of another. So the question is whether Christians have been given preferential treatment in the cathedral project. Now, since I don't have all the facts, it would be inappropriate for me to comment any further. And finally, the conclusion, you'll be happy to say. In my conclusion, this is what I have to say, ladies and gentlemen. Freedom of religion is recognized as a fundamental human right in liberal constitutions. It is also an essential prerequisite to religious tolerance. Freedom of religion and religious tolerance are core values not only in constitutional democracies, but in pluralistic societies which are undergoing a process of integration and national cohesion. Religious intolerance is a recipe for sectarian conflict and instability. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I realize that some of you may not be comfortable with departing from your established tradition of managing your educational institutions. And you may well feel that making a slight concession today may open the door for unwelcome erosion of your traditional practice. To those who feel that way, my respectful advice is to consider the long-term effect of that posture in a pluralistic society buffeted by radical and extreme sectarian forces. The question I will put to them is this: will resistance to some modest change stave off a more radical onslaught from without? On the other hand, will some accommodation diffuse an incipient explosion from within? It is my humble suggestion that the broader constitutional imperatives of national integration and inclusiveness compel us to strive towards accommodation in our diverse and pluralistic society. Ghana has achieved religious tolerance on a scale unknown in other countries. At the National Peace Council, representatives of various religions are able to pray and work together. Christian, Muslim, and traditional prayers are offered on public occasions without dissent. We have a long tradition of studying and working together in various institutions. Let us consolidate these values in a spirit of national reconciliation and inclusiveness. Thank you.
Please, let's keep standing for a while. I thought Nana would take a bow from us. Uh-huh. Nana is going to do that. Shall we give a clap offering even as she stands? Thank you very much. We have an interesting tradition. So we put this to the congregation. So what do you tell Nana? Now I am hearing this very often. So what do we tell Nana? Once more. And the third time. Well, Paul would say, so what shall we say? Except to recognize one thing. Nana Susubribi Krobia Asante, a.k.a. Dr. Samuel K.B. Asante, JSD, 1965. Shall we recognize him once more? I suspect it will be a disaster to attempt even to talk about what he has said. Nana, we accept everything you have said. On two grounds. The first one, who are we to challenge a whole Nana? And the second ground, a legal luminary. My learned senior, we are grateful to you, sir. The chairman wanted to know whether we should ask questions. It has not been our tradition at these meetings because this is a serious academic exercise tinged with religious, spiritual support. He mentioned that the laws recognize that faith should really not be contested. So who are we to contest what he has said? Nana, we are grateful unto you. We'll move on to the next item on our program. We have not heard our presiding bishop, who is being represented here today by Right Reverend Dr. Abuaji Mensah, Most Reverend. My sincere apologies. Most Reverend Dr. Robert Abuaji Mensah, who will share some reflections with us in the stead of our current sitting presiding bishop, the Most Reverend Titus Awotwiprat. But before then, shall we be on our feet to sing the church anthem? Shall we be on our feet to sing the church anthem? Seated. Our sight woman, do we have our singing band or are we going to have the choir to lead us? After the reflection, the choir or the singing band, I'm not sure who is going to be, if we have the singing band here. So after the reflection, we'll have the choir or the singing band. Presiding, sir.
Well, if you look at the program, if he said Right Reverend Abuaji Mensah, you don't have to be so worried because he's put the Right Reverend Titus Awotwiprat, so it's okay. Is that what you have in the program?
Yes.
Yes, so I mean there is no need to be worried about that. I want to make a very brief reflection, not on what had been said, but something that I think we need to do when we are thinking about democracy. And to help us to understand that the fundamental, the very grounds of democracy is very much biblical. During the 1630s, there were a group of Christians called the Puritans. They were being persecuted by the King of England. And so as part of the way of responding, they decided to leave England and go to the Newfoundland, United States. And when they were leaving, they had a very strong commitment that they wanted to build a new nation that has the Bible as its base in terms of its structure. And actually, that's why we have in America, you have what we call New England. You heard about that? That the old England was where the king and elders were persecuting them. And they are going to a new land to establish a nation which is a new England, because now all the foundations and things had to be based on the Bible. There's not going to be time for me to go into all the details, but when they were struggling to find out what kind of institution should be established, what should be the ground, the foundation, the structures of such an institution, they were reflecting and praying about this. And Isaiah chapter 33, verse 22, was a passage that led them to give the real form and structure of democracy. The passage reads, Isaiah 33, 22, "For the Lord is our judge. The Lord is our lawgiver. The Lord is our king. It is he who will save us." And they had this idea, just very briefly, there isn't time to go into all the details. The idea here is that it is only God alone, who can be the judge, who can be the lawgiver, and who actually can be the king. Because of their experience in Britain, when the king was persecuting them because they didn't want to be part of the Church of England. And so the idea came that a kind of governance or a form of governance that they need as a democratic one will be the one where there is a separation of powers. There will be a group that will be the Lord, the judges, the judiciary, based on this text. There should be a group who are the lawgivers, the legislature. And then there should be those who are the king, the executive. But of all this, the one who can truly save us is the Lord, when this is properly grounded. This is actually the biblical foundation for the democratic system that we have, where we have the structures, we have the judges, the judiciary, and then we have those who make the legislature is to make the law, but they are not the ones who are to interpret the law. And the work of the executive is to ensure that whatever the legislature have decided is properly executed. And if they don't, they come under the judiciary to make sure that they do what is right. And so here is the Bible biblical foundation for a democratic system of governance. And that is why in the American Constitution and so on, these three are checks and balances. And they have two important reasons for doing that. One is that because we are human beings created in the image of God, we are capable of doing what is good.
But because we are fallen human beings, if you give us all the chance, we'll always do the wrong thing. Because we want to do what is in our own interest. And therefore, to check, and I want you to listen very carefully to the Puritans. They said, we are capable of doing the good because of our faith in Christ and the Spirit of God living in us. But in order for the good to come out of us and to crush the evil, there should be checks and balances. And so, you find that the American Constitution still retains this. The French Constitution actually has, the nation is the one who, the people are the one who decides. So it's not surprising that the French Constitution has been changed about 5 or 7 times. But the American Constitution has still remained. God is the one who saves us. So when there is an issue for discussion, whether women should be, vote or whether slaves should vote, the question is, are they all human beings? And when they say yes, then you cannot change it. Because you cannot change the idea that the others, blacks or women, are not human beings. And so you don't change the Constitution. You change your ideas. Okay? Let me just, I said I will speak briefly, so I have to be brief. I'm closing. The other side to it is this. In our current constitution, as a nation, it appears it's a question of the winner takes it all. And after every kind of democratic and governance ending, the whole system has to be. Why? Haven't we granted the executive too much power to the extent that he has control, even though such systems are there? He is still the law, the judge, the lawgiver, and the king. And that's something for us as a nation to seriously think about. We may have a form of democracy, but are we not practicing one-party democracy? I end here. Thank you.
Our first thanks goes to the Lord Almighty for giving us the Methodist Church and filling it with learned people, spirit-filled and spirit-led. We are grateful to the Lord, and I'm so proud to be a Methodist, and I guess you are too. We thank the Lord for all the traveling mercies, for bringing people far and near to Koforidua to celebrate this day with us. And we know he's going to be with us all time. Now to our guest speaker, Nana. Your students might love you so much because if you lecture, they won't sleep and they won't get bored. I wasn't bored, and I had wanted you to go on and on and on. But with time, we are so grateful to you. We can imagine the number of hours you sat to dive into this topic to fill us with all the wisdom you've given us this day. May the Lord replenish you fully, Nana. Give you all the strength so that the next time we need you, you come and soak us in this way. Thank you very much, Nana. Now to the executive. We are grateful for you to lead the church in this way and giving us this day for us to have this very educative program. We pray for the Lord to give you all the strength so that you lead this church of ours to the glory of the Lord. Our next thanks goes to the late president. We are grateful to you for all that you've done for this wonderful gathering. The next one is to the administrative bishop. We are grateful to you. We know how tight your schedule is, but you are here. God bless you. Our next thanks goes to all bishops here. We are grateful for your support, and we know the Lord will keep on blessing you with wisdom and strength. Now to the families of our stalwarts, Mrs. Sophia Evelyn Moore, traveling all the way from so many areas to be here, and we love it. God bless you. We pray that the Lord takes you back home fully filled and fully strengthened. Our next thanks goes to all lay chairmen past and present, all lay presidents past and present, for all the support you've given us. We thank you so much for that. Now to our seasoned guests, may the Lord bless you for making this room filled to capacity. To the laity, we are grateful to you. If you hadn't been here, the program wouldn't have been successful. May the Lord bless each and every one of you. Now to the Bishop of Cofrodia and his team. Bishop Bosman, God bless you. Cofrodia is noted for hosting programs. And if I want to name them, I will number and number. God bless you, Bishop Bosman, and your team for everything. Now to all the singing groups, may God bless you. May your voices be as sweet as ever, so that anytime we meet, you sing for the Holy Spirit to be with us. The choir, the singing band, the gospel band, and everybody who sang this evening, God bless you. To the brigade, Aiko, we pray for the Lord to send you back home safe and sound. And we know that the Lord in his wisdom and his grace will do the same for us. Thank you very much. God bless you all and have a good night. Amen.